Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome to the channel. I'm Stylosa and this is going to be a meaty video. It's going to be pretty long. So I'd grab a drink, be like me and grab a Blizzard approved mug. And we're going to get stuck into this because what we've got, in fact, I'm going to move this over here because I've got a feeling that I'll spill it if I leave it where it was. This is Alec Dawson. He is the new, well, I'll just show you his bio. He is the lead hero designer on Overwatch 2. So this guy's taken over from Jeff Goodman. I believe he comes from the Hearthstone team, the balance team for Hearthstone, and he's moved over to Overwatch. Anyway, they hosted a space on Twitter where it's kind of like a chat back and forth. There was a bit of information in that, but what I'm interested in this video is this, because he actually said, drop any questions you have in the comments below and I'll jump on them after the Twitter spaces. And you can see there's like 400 comments. So all we're gonna do here is look at his replies, which we're looking at right now. And we're just gonna get stuck into them because there are a ton of replies. Hopefully we'll do most of them, but if the video gets super long, I might just end it and say, guys, check it out. But I think there's gonna be some cool stuff in this because of course this is the guy in charge of the balance of Overwatch 2 and new hero design. Okay, let's do this. So first question he gets asked, or rather the last question he responded to, whatever order this is in. How do you guys feel about Roadhog right now? Common sentiment is that he's pretty weak and I've had people complain when I pick him. But he's honestly felt pretty strong and his competition is getting nerfed too. And Alex says to this, the recent changes could be big for Roadhog. We know he also pairs pretty well with Kiriko as she can take care of a lot of his weaknesses. And in fact, another hero that Kiriko pairs extremely well with is Reaper, because again, she takes care of a lot of his weaknesses, because Reaper in Kiriko's Kitsune Rush, well, he's now got really fast rapid reload. He's got really fast rapid fire. Also, the passive that DPS get anyway means that he gets faster reload when he gets elimination. So he's just an absolute unstoppable killing machine. And if you watch Overwatch League, you'll just see loads of Reaper Kiriko comps literally in every game. Mirror matchups, kind of a bit bland, but whatever. And then he says, so we're in the wait and see phase, but we have tinkered with some changes to his kit. Nothing we love just yet. So the key takeaway here is they are looking at Roadhog and they have made some changes to his kit, but they're still waiting for data to come in. And they think that as Kiriko gets more prevalent in the game, that Roadhog might get stronger just because of Kiriko. So I think that's fair enough. So what about communication from the devs? Well, Alec was asked this. I wanted to ask if the balance team or other parts of the dev team are planning on being more vocal through the Overwatch official channels moving forward, even a we hear you kind of thing. It was great to hear you guys officially talk about the Doomfist issues. Now, they covered the Doomfist the weakness of Doomfist in the Twitter spaces, but I think he might go into a bit more detail on that in these comments as well as we get further on in the video. Anyway, he says in response to this, yes, and you'll find us trying that through a variety of platforms. Today went rather well. Hopefully we can make that a scheduled chat. From the design side, we want to share as much as possible. We'll probably see some blog posts dive into that, into our philosophies, which, you know, again, this is fine. Like, I do like the design blog posts. I think they're really cool content. Maybe there's some discussion from Blizzard's end whether it's actually worthy of them putting time into it, because maybe not a lot of people actually view the official website. What I would say to that is it does spawn a lot of shoulder content. Videos like this wouldn't be a thing unless they did these Twitter spaces and made the blogs and were open to the community. And, you know, actually listening to the devs and the devs having an avenue to speak to us, I think is a really good thing, because it lets us sort of get into their mind and see what direction they want to take the game in. I think, though, as ever, it's always a case of these developers need to be shielded from the absolute madmen on the internet. Now, I know this firsthand. I don't have a massive team of community managers and all this stuff in place to protect as layers of defense. It's just me. So if I'm doing my stuff and then people are coming at me, it's like I have to deal with that. So I totally get developers not wanting to be open to the riffraff on the internet, let's say, especially on social media platforms. It's never fun. Provided the devs are kept safe, that'll be good. We do want more communication as well. So good stuff. So what about new support characters? Any plans for making new support characters? They desperately need more characters. And Alex says, yes, it's one of our long-term focuses. Right now, the pool is quite small for two players to choose from. May see more new supports than other roles to bolster that pool. Also, there's still lots of interesting space for us to explore as designers when making support. Now, I do have a little additional bit of information here, because we know the next two supports after the next tank, which we're going to get in season two, the next two heroes are supports after the tank. So when this tank comes out, we get no hero the next season. So season 3 won't be a hero, but season 4 will be a hero. Season 5, no hero. Season 6, there will be a hero. That basically takes us to the end of next year, which is a pretty long time. So we're only going to get 2 more supports going into next year, but at least it's 2 more supports, and we desperately need supports because we need more options for support players to pick from. So it's good that he's mentioning this, but we kind of knew this already. Okay, so what about Symmetra and Moira? Hi, do you have any plans on reworking Symmetra or Moira? I think you guys mentioned it in the past, but we haven't heard about that for a while. Thanks for the amazing work. Mentioned in a few spots, but some small tweaks to Symmetra coming in Season 2. Okay, I think they did mention that in the Hero Update blog for Season 2. So there are minor changes coming to Symmetra. For Moira, though, we want to make sure we get it right. Tons of people love her playstyle, so we want to add... So we want any added utility to not break her flow and approachability. Have some ideas, but down the road a bit. So there you go. They don't want to change Moira. They want Moira to stay how she is, which is great news if you play a lot of Moira. Now, it might be annoying news if you play a lot of Genji and a lot of Moira is up your Genji destroying you or something like that, right? Moira is kind of a little bit frustrating to play against, but the reason why she's so prevalent in the game is because she can look after herself. She's like Kiriko in that sense. Kiriko's got a teleport, Moira's got a fate. They can get out of bad scenarios. But also, the thing with Moira is she can duel the flankers. If it's a bad Genji, if it's a bad Tracer, if it's some DPS that isn't cracked out of their mind and they're trying to fight the Moira can actually kind of deal with them. Worst case scenario, the Moira just forces them away. Best case, the Moira kills them. So Moira, I think, is going to be in games for a very, very long time. She's one of the easiest support characters to play in terms of value because you've got stuff in your kit to deal with everything. Now, when I say easy, I don't mean that you can just pick Moira and you'll get to GM and everything's great and fine. You won't, because the higher you'll get, things will get a lot more difficult. You'll start seeing Kiriko, Lucio comps all over the place and things like that instead of the Moira, because the Moira is not really offering enough to the team. But you could literally play Moira way up to you could probably get to GM, to be honest, with Moira, but you could definitely get into Masters if you got really good with the hero and really proficient. But what I mean about her being easy is just that she's got an option for every scenario. If she's getting pushed, she can either try and take the fight or she can fade away. If she's maybe caught by, I don't know, Cassidy magnetic grenade, she can fade away from it. If she's pulse bomb, she can fade away from it. She can counter a lot of things, and it's down to her to counter it, and the instant abilities as well. Fade instantly activates and you're taking no damage. That's huge. The fact that her primary, well, her secondary fire is slightly forgiving, although you obviously still need to aim it at the enemies, but the fact that it latches on and the fact that it gives you health off the target you're damaging is great in a 1v1 scenario. So there's a lot of things going on. And of course, her healing orbs are great. And her ultimate is really, really good in this Overwatch 2 economy because you can just beam down the squishes with it and you're practically invincible when using it. You're not, you just have rapid regen. You can still be killed. The enemy's got a good Cassidy or an Ash or a Sojourn fully charged railgun and they hit you, they can still kill you. But yeah, you've just got a lot of options. So I think the takeaway here is they don't want to change Moira. Maybe they're a little bit frightened to change Moira, but maybe Moira, you could argue, is the template for supports in Overwatch 2 going forward. Look at Kiriko. She follows a lot of Moira's key sort of tenants. She's very maneuverable, very survivable, has high damage potential. So I don't know. Interesting stuff, though. Okay, DPS passive. This is an interesting one. Are you considering to look at the DPS passive due to how the speed boost that gets provided from it benefits certain heroes like flankers a lot more than other DPS? Also, would you rebalance heroes like Genji if the DPS passive get changed? And Alex says to this, yes, DPS passive is at the top for changes in Season 2 for reasons you bring up, but also sentiment that it's hard to aim with on certain heroes. You see, that's interesting, isn't it? Because I would never... Okay, so hard to aim with the DPS passive. So think you just get faster reload, don't you? And your faster movement speed, little movement speed burst from it. But I guess that does screw up your aim if you just suddenly move forward a little bit. I would never have kind of said that. So it's interesting that he replies to that because he's kind of saying, I think what this is him saying like, yeah, it needs to be addressed because of its positives, but also it has negatives to maybe much lower skilled players. Now, I'm not an amazing Overwatch player. You know, I'm trash. I'm like an average Overwatch player these days, but I've never really noticed that the passive has messed my aim up, you know, but maybe it does way, way down in the rank. So I think this is Alec trying to say, yeah, we balance for the high end, but we're also balancing for the low end as well. Anyway, he also says, we like to see how heroes like Genji perform with the passive changes first, then evaluate from there, open to readjusting though. Okay, fair enough. So what about hero pick rates? Hey, Alec, is there a metric to track which heroes fall below average pick rate? Does the balance team see it as a major concern if there is a certain hero or heroes that are played at a low outlier rate? Would that be territory for a buff or a wait and see approach? And Alec says, it's okay to have niche heroes, but it raises questions. Is the kit lacking? Are players tired of the kit? Outside of win rate changes, players enjoy hero, but low pick rate equals less likely to do something. But players do not enjoy hero, and it's also got low pick rates, then they're more likely to do something. So that's kind of interesting. So I think that's, you can probably take that as almost their new philosophy on hero reworks. That is essentially outside of the win rate change. Players enjoy the hero, but it's got a low pick rate. Then they probably won't do much with it because that's maybe a balance issue. Maybe there's just some figures they could tweak, or maybe other heroes are a little bit stronger. But players don't enjoy the hero, and it's also got a low pick rate, means it's not a good hero design, so they're more likely to do something. So that's interesting stuff. Heroes in the battle pass. Yes, the favorite topic of mine. So, hi Alec. With future heroes unlocked via the battle pass, do you have any concerns gathering enough in-game data from players? My nose is itching. Gathering enough in-game data from players to make effective balance decisions. And he says, hey, no concerns. Tons of feedback and data comes in immediately with a new hero release. One of the more interesting moments for us to evaluate is when that hero enters competitive. There we see how coordinated teams take advantage of the hero's kit, especially at a high level. So, yeah, they don't... Not really going to say much about the hero in the battle pass, even though it's completely garbage. I can't imagine any game designer enjoys the fact the heroes are locked in the battle pass. It makes no sense. It's just done to make money, and I'm sure they'd want the heroes playable straight away. But yeah, that answer's sort of like they just wait until the hero goes into competitive. Fair enough. So what about the frequency of balance patches? Why balance patches every month and not every 2 weeks? Is it because of crossplay and issues with consoles requiring confirmation on updates, or something else? And Alex says, believe this cadence is good, allows metas to develop, and gives us enough time to have changes we are confident in, gathering data, coming up with changes, and then playtesting the changes. We'll note that there are our schedule changes. If anything was very out of line, we'd step in ASAP. So the funny thing with this is we've got a mid-season patch, which is coming out on the 15th of November. That's a very long time away. That's like 2 weeks away. It was basically 3 weeks away when they announced the changes that were coming in. Something must have happened there to cause the delay. I don't know whether that's some sort of engineering issue on Blizzard's side or something. I don't know, but that's still heavily delayed. Balance patches every 2 weeks is probably too fast. I think the mid-season balance patch they've got at the moment is great if they can do it in the mid-season, which of course isn't really the case for this one because it's a little bit delayed. It's also weird because Overwatch League are playing on the patch, yet we're not. So if you watch Overwatch League right now, it's on the new updated patch. It's not on the current version of the game we're playing, which is kind of a little bit weird, although I think most players won't even recognize that it's on a different patch, so things might maybe look stronger on Overwatch League and they're not on live. But then again, Overwatch League, these players are like gods to us. Like, you know, we're mere mortals, so it's difficult for us to sort of look at their play and go, okay, well, I'll just implement that in comp and I'll get better. It doesn't really work like that. But I think there are some issues I've got with this balance. Blizzard have said they wanted to be more, I guess, faster with balance, faster with changes. You've only got to look at Doomfist. This hero is absolutely kippered. He's just not great at the moment. He needs a bit of love. I don't know why they can't give him love. Also, Sojourn, although they did say, and actually Alec did say in the Twitter spaces about Sojourn, that actually Sojourn's only good in Masters and above. Well, I'd say, well, hang on, I'm only like trash diamond at the moment. Sojourn is very good in my games, and she was very good all the way through plat as well, and she was actually pretty good in high diamond, where at high gold as well when she plays. And now I know players are all mashed together and these are not the actual ranks of people. It's going to take time for players to work out their rank, but yeah, I would say that she's pretty good at a lot of levels. Now granted, at lower levels, when she's firing at a target, she gets fully charged rail, so she primary fires, spams away, gets fully charged rail, probably misses quite a lot with the rail, whereas higher ranks are going to hit more with it. But yeah, I think they should have sorted Sojourn out. They should have reduced the amount of time that you hold the rail for. I think it's around 8 seconds at the moment. It might even be longer. It seems like too long. Half that, or even make it maybe three seconds of fully charged rail, because it's too much at the moment. And there's probably other things they could do to the hero. But yeah, it's pretty slow balance philosophy at the moment. And they're sort of saying the reason why is because, hey, we want to let metas develop and things like that. But I would say there are glaring issues with certain heroes, and I don't think it takes much to just go, you know what, we'll fix those heroes. But hey, I'm not Blizzard. So what about Bastion? Well, hello and thank you for the opportunity. With the current state that Bastion is in, is there any tweaks or reworks in the pipeline at the moment? Bastion feels significantly weaker compared to the rest of the DPS cast and performs worse than the Overwatch 1 counterpart of the hero. This is not true, and I don't know what this person is talking about. Bastion at the moment is cracked out of his mind. In fact, I've got a video, and I've got a recording of a game, and I'm tempted to turn it into a video. I'm playing Reinhardt, and I've got a Bastion. You literally babysit your Bastion, and all he does is just annihilate the enemy tank. In every single engagement, just goes to tank mode, piles damage into the enemy tank. Need a Zen as well for this. Zen discords, and you just destroy the target over and over. It's like stupidly OP. So I actually think Bastion is a hell of a lot better than he was in Overwatch 1. Way better. This comment's crazy. So let's see what Alec actually says. So the Bastion bug with tons of artillery fire was actually quite eye-opening. Players still avoided it. Okay. I don't know what he means by that. Maybe players avoided picking Bastion or avoided abusing the bug. A few changes in mind, but we want to shorten the window before the projectile drops so players can feel more effective during configuration artillery. Okay, so they want to buff his ultimate here, which is interesting because his ultimate, if you've got a Zarya as your tank and you're playing Bastion, just combo it with the Graviton and it's just free kills, free team fights a lot of the time. Yeah, there are ways of mitigating it. You know, a D.Va can eat the projectiles, Genji can deflect them and things like that. But a lot of the time it will get tons of kills because they just won't be able to react to it. But that's interesting to say that they want to change Bastion's ultimate. I think Bastion's actually pretty good at the moment. I really do. I think he's really, really good. So what about Symmetra? Can you comment on where Symmetra is in development? Is there any plans to buff or change her kit? What is her identity in Overwatch 2 since she can do a little bit of everything? Good question, because Symmetra is a hero from a bygone era. She's a defense hero. Well, she was a support, then she became a defense hero, and she's based on stationary turrets, which the game is highly mobile, so yeah, she has lots of issues. Anyway, he says, Symmetra is doing quite well across most of our ranks. In the right hands, we've seen players find great usage with her current kit. She does, however, have a low pick rate, and we hear a lot of feedback about her. Expect to see some small tweaks to her kit in Season 2. So I think what's interesting here is this is that new philosophy they've got in progress. So players enjoy the hero, but she's not really picked that much. So maybe we need to do a little bit of a change. It's not players hate the hero and then players don't play the hero, then they would change it. It's players do like the hero, but they don't play her a lot. Or players maybe like the hero or don't like the hero, but she's very effective. It's weird, isn't it? So I don't think that Symmetra at the moment for Blizzard is ticking both those boxes of boring to play, low effectiveness. It's sort of like maybe she's boring to play, depends on who you talk to. Maybe she's fun to play, depends on who you're talking to. But the one constant is she's actually quite effective based off the stats Blizzard have got, which I think is quite interesting. What I think to say about Symmetra is her primary fire is an absolute killer. You know, if that's fully charged and you're just piling damage into anybody, that is a absolute weapon. So you've got to be super careful of that. I think my issue with Symmetra has always been, like I said, stationary turrets. You can still throw your turrets on the floor and then teleport them into the enemy backline. You can use the turrets in some good positions to be annoying, but it's almost like that part of a kit is sort of like an afterthought. And all you're really playing with is primary, secondary fire and maybe a cheeky teleport. Although her ultimate is very good as well. So yeah, Symmetra is a difficult one, I think, for Blizzard to crack. So why is there a delay on the patch notes? Now this is, I kind of sort of ad-libbed and touched on this a little bit, but we've got an answer here. So we'll go through this. I may have missed this earlier in Spaces, but why is it going to take until November the 15th to implement the changes shown in the blog post? That seems like a long time for value tweaking. And maybe if then statement or two, while also stating that it will be ready in 2 days for OWL. Yeah, which makes sense, you know, because it's in OWL, but it's weeks away for us. Alex says, for full transparency, we did want this patch to come out earlier for the player base at large, but had some issues on our side. You can expect future mid-season balance patches to happen about 4 weeks after a season starts. So that's good news to hear, and it is good that it was some sort of technical problem Blizzard had. I think they're having a lot of teething issues, this whole changing the team to support a game as a live service to make more content, the different ways they do updates and all of this stuff now. I guess it's just like a learning process for Blizzard and they're finally getting there. So I think this is fine. You know, this is cool. At least they've explained why it was delayed. What about buffing healer damage? This is an interesting one. Will there be any buffs to healers' damage, just so healers can defend themselves? And is Zarya getting nerfed? And Alex says, defending yourself as a support can come through in a variety of ways. We want to be very careful with just buffing their damage, as they turn into DPS heroes with healing. Movement is much safer option, as it keeps the support tank DPS paradigm, intact. Which is true, because the thing with, I don't think supports need more damage. I don't think that solves the support issue. I think, obviously I made a video on this recently and spoke about the way supports are, the playstyle has changed. So it's less about you sitting there and almost healing your team as your primary focus. It's more about supporting your team, which is done through various abilities. It's also done through additional damage. It's also done through, your positioning, not dying and stuff. But then also thrown into this paradigm, that's still the word, is the whole idea of you are getting pressured from the side. You've got one less tank. You need to deal with these flankers yourself. Your tank probably isn't going to peel for you. I wish they would. I wish D.Va players would peel more, but they probably won't. And if they don't, then you've got to look after yourself, whether that's both the supports working together or whether that's you being more independent, which again goes back to the whole idea why you see a lot of Moira getting played, because Moira is very independent and very high value when it comes to dealing with the flankers, and Kiriko is as well. I don't think they're going to buff the damage, but they may add movement. I mean, this, again, I think it's a little bit of a teaser for new heroes coming down the line. We know we're going to get two new supports next year. They're probably going to follow the path of Kiriko and Moira. Most notably Kiriko, that is a more offensive healer, a more offensive support, rather than a stationary support that's more immobile. They want fluidity in the gameplay. They want you doing things at all times. And you can also see this in Orisa's redesign. Orisa is firing with a primary fire, then she's throwing a spear, then she's got spear spin, then she's got fortify. There's a lot Orisa can do. Old Orisa just put a shield down and just shot behind it. It was kind of boring, right? They like giving heroes more stuff to do, and it makes you feel like you're doing more stuff and you're having more fun, I think. I think it's good game design. So Kiriko, if you ignore Kiriko's voice acting, which I think isn't great, but Kiriko's kit is phenomenal. Kiriko is my favorite support to play right now. It is so good. The way her kit functions in 5v5 is just incredible. So more healers like that, let's go. So what about balancing for high and low levels? So if a hero is performing in high elo, overperforming in high elo, but underperforming in low elo, they don't receive immediate nerfs. Shouldn't the game be balanced from the top down? Alex says, we mainly nerf heroes due to their performance in high elo. So yes, the game is primarily balanced from the top down. When it comes to changes, we do our best to find changes that hit that top level efficiency without butchering the hero at lower ranks. Hard to do, but it's the goal. See, this is the weird thing. If they say that, he says that, why haven't they looked at Sojourn? Sojourn is incredibly powerful at high ranks. And I still believe she must be powerful at lower ranks, because I've seen this, like I said, going through gold and working my way up. I've seen this, I play it and I'm clicking on heads and deleting people. And it's like, what? I'm getting more value on that hero than I would on a soldier or on a Cassidy, although I do like playing Cassidy. I still like Cassidy. He's got a sweet spot in my heart. I love that hero. But yeah, I don't know about this. Surely you would have nerfed, if this was your balance philosophy, you would have nerfed Sojourn. You would have gone, okay, we need to bring down this railgun power. But they haven't. And I guess that's only because the stats state that she's so bad at lower ranks that they just don't want to touch her. But also she dominates the top ranks of the game. So if you're balancing from top-down philosophy, surely you would have looked at her. I don't know, it's weird. So this is the thing with Blizzard. It's that everything gets a little bit mixed sometimes. What about Tracer? So Alec, what are your thoughts about Tracer at the moment? She feels weak because she can no longer go all out on her targets and recall, since she lacks the damage to do so. Should Tracer players find a better way to utilize the hero, or is she underperforming overall? Now this is cool, this is. I've not played much Tracer. I've not really seen that much Tracer. Yeah, in the early alphas for Overwatch 2, Tracer was everywhere. I think she may have been slightly nerfed though since then. But Tracer was everywhere and it was like, oh my god, Tracer's super flanker, dead fast, she can always disengage with rewind, she can go and get health packs if she needs to, she's super independent, she's just an amazing character. Yet we've not really seen her, have we, in Overwatch 2 at the moment. So let's see what Alex says to this. She's been overshadowed by some of the other flankers in the hero lineup so far due to meta and other hero strength. Believe she will find a home and composition with these changes and others coming. If she doesn't, we'll be taking a closer look at her kit. Interesting. So they must be expecting, with the Genji nerf, which is Genji's nerfed into oblivion. So come the 15th of November, Genji's just going to do less damage, and he's just nerfed into oblivion. Maybe you see Tracer coming back as a result of that. Especially if you're looking to run some sort of flank, and maybe you see Tracer Sojourn as like the go-to DPS comp or something like that. Interesting, but they're definitely waiting to see what happens before they buff her. But what is, I think, really interesting here is he says if she doesn't, we'll be taking a closer look at her kit. So if she doesn't come back, then they will take a look at her and try and buff her. That's interesting, isn't it? It's almost like they want her in the meta. Which, is that a bad thing? I don't know. But why remove Genji from the meta? Oh, that's right, because his season's nearly finished and his mythic skin's no longer, you know, we can't have him super buff now. His mythic skin's going to be old news soon. And then the next hero, maybe Tracer's got the next mythic skin. Maybe that, if she has, maybe that's why we'll see her get super buffed. What about Mercy buffs? Okay, well, this is going to be interesting because he did speak about Mercy, I think, in the Twitter space. Can we expect any buffs to Mercy? Her movement feels great, but it seems she lacks the playmaking impact of other supports have. I agree with this. Honestly, Raphael, I agree with this. Do you follow me? You don't. I hate you, Raphael. But I agree with this, right? Because this is something I think I've said quite a few times. But yeah, like, I wish Mercy had, like, impact. Like, it's always been that thing of, like, Mercy doesn't, like, have burst healing. Mercy's got good healing. But if a target's dying, it's like with Mercy, he's just looking at the target like, please don't die. Please don't die. Oh, you're dead. Maybe I can res you. Oh, I'm dead. I don't know. But I think Mercy's still pretty good, though, in Overwatch 2, because the movement's great. Like, a good Mercy's really good. Anyway, let's see what he says. Enough of me rambling. Overall, players are still learning and adjusting to her new movement capabilities. We want to give that a little bit of time and see how those learnings translate to win rate. May see some small tweaks through that time frame, though. Okay, so they're still waiting on Mercy, and they still think players need to learn how to play the hero, basically, and then they might change her. Interesting stuff. A lot of people have replied to that. It's always Mercy. It's always, like, controversial. But yeah, I think that's fine. That's okay. Yes, my favorite topic, Sojourn nerfs. Can we expect Sojourn nerfs? I've seen her in almost every comp game I've played this season, around 3-1-5 at this point. Oh, that must be how many comp games they've played. And her kit is just too strong compared to other DPS. And Alex says she's top of our mind for Season 2 changes, particularly looking at her one-shot capability without losing hero identity too much. But I don't, like, what I find really funky is why they're waiting for Season 2. It's clearly super OP right now. Like, Overwatch League is the best example I can give of this. If you go and watch Owl, it's on right, well, it's not on, well, it might be on right now if you're watching this video when it's on, but it's on until the, is it the 4th or the 5th of November? Basically every day, then the grand final. I think it's the 4th of November, the grand final is, although don't quote me on that. But you'll just see the fights. All that happens is positioning. Sojourn charges up off a Winston bubble and then looks for a headshot. Boom, gets a kill across the map, then they just go in. That's all it is. It's a lot of it is just waiting for the Sojourn. Or if Kiriko's got her ultimate ready to go, then they throw that on the floor and then Reaper just rushes in and kills everyone. That's all that's happening. But it's all based around this one-shot ability of the Sojourn. Now, I would be lying if I said this isn't cool to watch, because it definitely is. Sojourn, high-skill players clicking on people and blowing them away is fun to watch. But when it's in your game, maybe it's not, because you're like, well, gee whiz, I'm dead again. I picked Ashe and I've been deleted because there's simply a better hero than me. Now, there was also confusion of people saying, Stai, Sojourn ain't a hitscan hero. What are you talking about? Okay, technicality. You know, a primary fire is a projectile, but her alternate fire, the railgun, is a hitscan weapon. So she's, I guess, a hybrid hitscan projectile, but the power is the railgun. It's not the primary fire. The primary fire just charges the railgun, and the railgun is what you're looking for. So yeah, she is a hitscan hero. But yeah, I don't know. All I'd say to this is, why aren't you nerfing her now? Do they want her to stay at this level for Overwatch League for some reason? Are they happy with the way the game is at the moment? I don't know. It is, I think, a little bit strange, because you say one thing that we're going to balance from the top down, and if something's overpowered, we're going to look at it, and then they don't implement it. It's weird, isn't it? What about tank diversity and balance? How do you guys feel about tank diversity, particularly in terms of tanks who share composition style? Ryan, Junker Queen, Zarya, Orisa, all Brawl, for example. How much of improving that plays into hero design versus balance versus map design? Symmetric beam updates. Okay, well, he says it plays a significant role. At the outset of a new hero, we establish what archetype they fit into for game needs. Goal here is to have more diversity for different tank playstyles and finding new spaces for the role in general. Shooting barriers will be good for you again. Oh, okay. So he's okay. So that's the tease in the Symmetra change. They're going to probably let a charge up off barriers again, because I think they removed that, didn't they? So maybe that's the tweak there. But yeah, on tanks, it's just they want more diversity. I think they would say that for every category in the game. Different tank playstyles and finding new spaces for the role in general. I mean, tanks have changed a lot, haven't they, in Overwatch 2? I mean, you are now a jacked up DPS, essentially. And yeah, I don't know. Like, I think I can't wait to see what the next tank hero looks like, which is coming out in Season 2. But I think I'm more interested in seeing what the supports look like in the following seasons, to be honest. Do we need another tank hero? I don't know. I'd have preferred it if they just went mad and just give us loads of supports. But obviously, they want to give us a tank hero, so I don't know. I'll take that. But yeah, that's fine, I guess. How do they balance Overwatch 2? What is their philosophy? How do you guys go about balancing Overwatch 2? Do you listen more to the top level of play, or do you mostly just look at general win rates and balance off that? Well, I do apologize. And Alex says, would love to cover this in a blog post. Lots to say. But in short, it's a combination of intuition, feedback, and data. We try to look at changes that account for how that character is being played across ranks that can differ greatly and retain character identity. So they've always spoke about this. They've always spoke, haven't they, about maybe this philosophy's changed, but they had a triangle, didn't they? Like a balanced triangle, and it was player sentiment, data, and then what they think should be changed, and then they sort of try and balance that. Whereas if the data says this hero is really bad, then obviously it needs to be changed. But that data, as he's saying, is data across all ranks. So if the hero is bad across every rank, they'll look at it. But if the hero is great in low ranks, but maybe not great in high ranks, they might not change it if people enjoy playing the hero. Yeah, so that's their balance philosophy. I don't think much has really changed there. What about buffing Doomfist? All right, big question, let's go. Are there any plans to buff the weaker tanks? Wrecking Ball, Doomfist, and Junker Queen all feel very weak and impossible to play in a one-tank format. That's not true. They're not impossible to play. Doomfist is. Doomfist is. He needs fixing. Junker Queen can still be okay in some scenarios. Her problem is she does kind of get heavily countered by other tanks. That's an issue she's got, but she's very good at fighting everybody else. And I think... Wrecking Ball is all over the place. I've played against Wrecking Balls that have just destroyed the entire team. Like, and I can't do anything. They're annihilating us. They're just slamming the back line, killing the supports, rolling out there, even taking on the front line. They're smashing everyone, knocking out loads of environmental kills. So you will get the odd Wrecking Ball, which is really great. But I think the issue is Wrecking Ball is almost played like a flanker, where he isn't really getting any kind of support from his team. He's just off on his own, doing his own thing. Anyway, Alex says, for sure, hinted at the changes to Doomfist in Season 2, enabling more empowered punches. Now, do you want a punch bot Doomfist? Do you want a Doomfist that literally charges up his empowered punch easier or faster from his power block and then can punch a bit more aggressively? And then all Doomfist is about is punching, Do you want that? Or do you want a Doomfist that's highly mobile and was like his DPS counterpart back in Overwatch 1? And he kind of was like this to begin with in Overwatch 2. I think having a punch bot Doomfist isn't the best way to go. Yeah, I know the player hero fantasy, massive gauntlet. You want to punch people with this, and it does feel a bit weedy when you slam somebody into a wall and it doesn't really do anything to them. You want them to be taking tons of damage, right, and all of that stuff. But I still think this hero was great in the alphas and even in the betas, because he was highly mobile and he could really disrupt the enemy team. Yeah, he could isolate targets and do damage to them enough to kill them, but he was basically about going in, smashing the team all over the place, creating loads of confusion, singling out targets that maybe could be dove upon. He was really, really good, but Blizzard have just removed his mobility. And now he's just not great. So I don't know about this, but they're going to buff his fist. We'll have to wait and see what they do with this. They either go for more damage, they either go for more sort of range on the knockback of it, because it hits multiple targets when it's empowered. Maybe it has a better stun component to it, or a longer stun component. But then we know they don't like stuns. But then do they like stuns now because they've got a completely new lead hero designer? Who knows? Anyway, also on Junker Queen and Wrecking Ball, he says Queen buffs would look at her self-sufficiency versus providing sustain for the whole team. Ball is a bit trickier, knife's edge for balance. So you've got to remember with Junker Queen, she was massively OP until they nerfed her Commanding Shout. Commanding Shout was giving too much health to her allies, so it was too powerful, and then it had to be nerfed, and it got nerfed. And it's interesting that they're saying here that they want to look at her self-sufficiency versus providing sustain for the team. So do you give her the potential to keep herself alive through applying all the wounds that she's got. Do you buff that or do you increase that? Or do you maybe lower that, rein it in a little bit, and give a bit more power back to her team in a defensive capacity? It's interesting to see. But I don't think Junk Queen is dying for buffs at the moment. I think she's kind of okay, and she's had a moment in the limelight where she was overpowered, but I think she's kind of okay. Ball, though, he says he's trickier. He's on a knife's edge for balance. And I apologize. Slap the microphone. I wish you went into more detail on Wrecking Ball, because Ball, I think, like I said, Ball can be devastatingly powerful in the right hands if you buff him too much. Ball is devastatingly powerful if it's a good player. But then if you buff him too much, he becomes super powerful, because even right now, it's very hard to kill Ball. Ball can hit you and disengage, Compare him to Doomfist. Doomfist can hit you and disengage and just do nothing to you, but Ball can slam you, shoot you, and do a ton of damage and get the hell out of there before you can even do anything back to him. Ball wins in a lot of 1v1s against most of the cast. Obviously not against other tanks, but against a lot of the supports, against a lot of the DPS, you will kill them. If you've been playing Soldier and you get a Ball slam on top of you, it's like, well, I guess I'm dead. So if they buff his damage or buff his survivability, then he's going to get out of control. So I think this is an admission that they won't buff Ball for a pretty long time. Okay, that's basically all of his responses, but I do kind of want to end on this. Bad Passion Mari asks, are there any planned changes to the Cassidy nade? I would have liked to have seen the answer to this, but he obviously chose not to answer this question. Maybe he didn't see it. Maybe he had to go. I don't know. But I would have liked an answer to that, because I think it's very annoying. It's almost like Flash was less annoying. But the magnetic grenade gets me so many kills because I'm trash. Like, if a Genji's near you, or literally if any DPS is near you, you body shot them and lob the nade at them, you'll probably kill them. And it's disgusting, and it does make me laugh every time it happens, but it probably does need to get looked at. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening and watching to the video. I hope this has given you a good insight into the new lead hero designer of Overwatch 2 and maybe some changes to balance philosophy going forward. It is interesting that he's chosen to be quite outspoken in this role. Of course, Jeff Goodman was also outspoken. Jeff would post on the forums, he would post on Reddit AMAs. He was involved in quite a lot of live streams, but never really in this capacity on Twitter, which is interesting to see. And they do say they will do more of these Twitter spaces, which are basically a recording you can, well, it's a live, almost like a podcast kind of thing. It's basically listening into a phone call between two or more people. In this case, it was listening to Mr. X, Matt from Overwatch League, asking the questions to Alec, and he's just answering the questions back and forth. And it was pretty cool. About half an hour or so, I think, or maybe 20 minutes or so of recording, which is pretty decent. But yeah, more information, being more open with the community is always a good thing. And I love getting into the sort of the head of the people behind the balance and the design of the game, because it does show us where the game is going to go in the future. And I think that's really cool. All right, guys, thank you for listening and watching to the video. I've been Stylosa. Follow me on everything, which is at Stylosa. And yeah, I will catch you lovely, lovely lot on the next video. And if you enjoyed the video, keep subscribing, liking, and all that stuff. And I'll see you on the next one. See you soon.